Hey everybody, welcome to the stream. I'm going to be working on this image of the wizard, the chimp, and the bird. I don't know what it's called yet. These are just random characters that I made up, and I'm just trying to play with a brush and Krita and kind of draw in a little bit of a different way than I have been in the past. So I'm trying to do something that's a bit more painterly with my drawing, but also have that kind of inked pencil look. So hopefully this ends up being a nice kind of in between. If you want me to get into the weeds, which probably nobody does, but I'm gonna do it anyway. I had a pencil brush in Clip Studio, which I was using a lot, and I really like it a lot for certain things, but bringing it over into paintings has been a little difficult in the way that it doesn't really meld very well with the final painting. It adds too much sharpness, too many little textural details everywhere. So I'm trying to find a happy medium. The brush itself in Clip Studio is really great for just drawing, like to refine a drawing that you start, like a sketch, and like I'll sketch in Photoshop with like a chalk brush, refine that in Clip Studio with a pencil brush because you can get really fine detail and really like accurate brushwork, and then move over into Krita for like this stage.
Mm-hmm.
It's all pretty quick. Mm-hmm. So I'm kind of always like making myself go really fast, and I don't need to do that. I need to take my time a bit more. But
I'm watching too much Sonic.
Yeah, I'm watching way too much Sonic the Hedgehog. But yeah, that's what this is. It's me just taking my time, doing a big drawing before I paint anything. So yeah, I'm going to be working on the whole background element of this, which is like a big vine structure plant element. But yeah, I'm joined by my beautiful wife, which you can't see right now because she's not sure if she's gonna be hanging here.
Not convenient to be called beautiful off camera.
Yeah, I'm
being recorded.
I'm not holding her here because there's a chance that she might have to escape. I've had stomach troubles for like 3 days straight now.
Which designer Dash said, who else is gassed? And I said, Dave is really gassy right now. So hopefully everyone saw that in the chat.
It's very true. So anyway, if you're curious as to like what program I'm using right now, this is all Krita. This video will probably be this stream will probably be entirely Krita.
Mm-hmm.
Krita's free. You can donate if you really love it, but it's free.
Mansur had asked, what's this for?
For nothing.
For
it's
fun.
It's just to make stuff for myself and for Patreon. You know, it's the benefit of having a Patreon is that I'm able to do work like this and not feel guilty. Like I'm taking time away from clients or something.
Mm-hmm.
So it's nice.
Someone asks, how do you get the crisscross looking texture on the skin in this piece, if you don't mind me asking?
The crisscross look?
Mm-hmm.
This right here, it's just the brush that I'm using. You can kind of, yeah, I'll show you real quick off to the side. So if I make another layer and I'm just shading a ball, right? I take my brush and without lifting it off of the canvas, I just kind of drag it across like this. And I get this line that kind of links to itself. It's like, I think it's called magnetic in Krita. That's how they say it. So like the brush stroke kind of pulls together. So it kind of feels like you're drawing with the side of a pencil, I guess, if I had to compare it to something. But yeah, that's how I'm doing it. I'm just kind of shading like this and adjusting my pressure that I'm putting down. It's pretty fast. But it's a weird brush. You got to get used to it. But once you're used to it, I feel like it's a very quick process to get like, you know, nice results.
Cool. Designer Dash says you can't emulate that brush in Clip Studio in Photoshop.
No, not really.
Yes, you're stuck looking at Kim's beautiful, gassy husband.
It's very true.
More people joining, saying hello. What music are they listening to?
This like synth music playlist that was on YouTube.
Oh.
That I found.
When I was in the third grade, I thought that I was... That one?
Yeah, that's what I should have
that opened synth with. Music? I love how you do your like greenery stuff and like florals.
Yeah.
I love how you do it. That one. Remember that one sketch that you did when you were like drawing like flowers or bouquets or whatever, trying to get an idea for our wedding?
No, a loose one. I don't remember.
You did it with like a drawing of like what I described I wanted my wedding dress to be like.
Oh yes, I do remember. You remember the drawing?
Mm-hmm. Well, remember I asked you, I like kind of described it to you, mm-hmm. like a long time ago, and didn't you draw it in that diner in New Hampshire?
I can't remember, probably.
I think it was like on the tablecloth, and I ripped it, and I saved it, and then like however many years later, 3 years later, because it was like early in the relationship. I think 3 years later, yeah, we got married, and then I like found it again in our box of memories, and I was like, oh my god, my dress actually kind of looked like this.
Right.
Remember that? It was that diner, like that, it was like when we went back, you know, from Germany when we had to fly to mm-hmm. Boston for your dad's funeral, and so it was like that time, so it was like super early in our relationship, which is really funny. But anyway, you drew flowers then, and I have always loved how you've drawn flowers.
I know, it's like any sort of Baroque stuff mm-hmm. or natural things like flowers and trees.
The like things but you can make them very ornate. It's so yeah, pretty.
It's where my ADD, like not ADD, but like my obsessive side of that yeah, sort that, of like, thing hyper-focus. Kicks in, where I could do that sort of detail work forever. I could spend just countless hours, which is like nice to have. This brush in particular, because I feel like it cuts down on how much time I'd spend doing it, because mm-hmm. it implies a lot of detail that I would have done by hand.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it, huh? You probably would have done like a little of that cross-hatching to give that, mm-hmm. especially something like that, more organic, some texture.
Yeah, it's a really nice change. inking just kills me sometimes.
Jordan Courtney said, your voice is like really soothing, which I'm guessing they're talking about yours, because nobody ever says that about like a. I don't. People rarely say that about a woman's voice unless it's real low.
Unless it's handsome.
Yeah, like high pitched voices are not very soothing.
Thanks. Yeah, it's funny like how many times people have been like,
"You should do radio."
Yeah, do radio. It's like, yeah. Do a dying medium.
Mm-hmm.
I could be a VTuber. I could be one of those like Twitch. Whatever they are, those like anime, there's like an anime character moving.
Okay, I see what you're
and
saying.
I just talk.
Yeah, just be the voice.
I could be like, what's his name?
You need to be...
Corpse. What's that dude's name?
Mm-hmm. I know who you're talking about.
Corpse husband.
Yeah. Is that what it is?
I can't remember, but...
I know who you're talking about. The one with like the super voice.
Yeah, I could talk like that. I could get sick and get a little deeper.
Hey, Dan. Dan's here. Dave Raposa ASMR. Do you want like the mouth ASMR? Or I mean he's been farting a lot. We could put the mic down there. You can hear
just on, me smacking my lips and
farting in a leather chair. In a warm leather chair.
There's definitely a market for that. Don't deny.
No, I just saw this girl who was like, I'm not a 10. But life in Minnesota is pretty good because 23,000 people pay me $10 a month to watch me ice fish and fish.
Wow.
I'm like, what? Are you kidding me? That's your, like, if I could, what? Does somebody have, like, any fetishes for people who need to cook? Because I'll just do that and you guys could pay me for that, you know? Make it all ASMR-y, whatever.
It's just a very quiet video where you can't see my face. Mm-hmm. It's just the lower half of me cooking, like, mm-hmm. you know, desserts and stuff. And then just like half an hour into it, I just violently shit my pants. Just so loud, just no, that'd be a good kind of stream.
Speaking of, you were
and
burping.
And just talk over and go, holy shit, just eating a cookie.
You were burping in here, like super loud, and the boys were like, what was that? And Luke's like, I need to go check on Papa. Is he okay?
Of course.
So funny. Like, yeah, you were just like, because you were basically like shouting in here while you were burping because it was like coming out so powerfully. It was so stupid. Oh. I'm glad that wasn't your fart, though, that I heard. And you sounded like a yell.
Somebody screaming. If my ass screamed, that would be wild.
I don't know if you guys know this, but this is a story I've told very quickly in passing because it was just a very short story. But one time, Dave woke me up laughing, like, oh my god, doing a terrifying laugh. He woke me up and he was like, ha 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 ha. And it was so fake, but it was so loud. And I was like, why is he still up? And I look over at him, and this motherfucker's sleeping. His eyes are closed. And I woke him up, and I was like, are you okay? That was so scary. It was so terrifying to wake up. And then you started really laughing, because you were like, oh, I was? Yeah, there was like a really funny joke in my dream or something. It's like one of the scariest things to wake up to. Oh, I think you told me the joke, but I can't remember what it was.
I had a wild dream that was a joke dream, which I actually probably can't tell on this.
Do I know what it is?
Yeah, I told you it was really stupid.
Was it from recently?
Yeah, it was the other day. I told you, like, it was, like, the first thing I told you when I woke up.
Oh, my God. You might have to remind me. I don't remember.
I was thinking, like, what's the punchline of this if I were to tell it? And I was like, I can't tell that.
Okay. Okay, you're going to have to tell me later because I can't remember.
Sorry, everybody. It's like, you know, when you try to remember your dreams and you kind of vaguely remember them. It just came back to me and I was like, oh, can't tell that. Too crazy.
There have been times, though, where I'm like, I get up before you when I was going to nursing school, and I'm like, I just wake you up to say bye, wake you up to start your day, and you're like, hey, wake up, and then you're like, and then you, literally, the first thing out of your mouth was a joke, like, you woke, and then you don't even remember it, because you were just waking up, and then I go throughout my day, and I'm like, what the fuck was that, and then I come home, and I tell you, and you're like, I told you that joke. Yeah, you've told me jokes when you were sleeping. It's the weirdest thing. Like, I feel like, it's like, you're always on, you're always thinking about something funny.
Yeah, it's definitely weird.
Uber says, Uber, like the Uber says, can you hide a smiley face somewhere? It'll be a secret between you and chat.
We'll see. We'll see how discreet I can get it.
Aseas Paredes says, I saw one called A Playlist for 19th Century Villain Planning to Destroy the World.
Yeah, there's so many of these, like, YouTube playlists that you can just leave on. Like, I've never listened to this before. I just come on and put one on before the stream just to make sure it doesn't get taken down.
Riley says, you should be a Garfield VTuber.
That's actually a good idea.
We remember the other day you were like, I used to be able to do Garfield's voice.
Yeah.
And you're, like, getting close.
Yeah, I can't debut that yet.
It's It's not ready.
It's not ready. It's still cooking. I'm still working on it. I have the right pitch, though. I can get there.
Felix said that you should do ASMR with goblin or witch noises. You could do that easily.
Well, that's Dan's wheelhouse.
Dan's wheelhouse is Dan that Cockney that. Accent.
That old thing.
That stupid Cockney accent.
Yeah, the Cockney accent. Yeah.
Mansur says, Dave, you worked on a ton of different projects. Do you get a lot of repeat business from the same clients?
Yeah, definitely. It's sporadic, though. It's not like it, you know, I count on it like every year or something like that. Unless it's something like magic or, you know, a job where they put out a lot of products and I work on the illustrations for that. Like Hasbro hires me a lot. But in terms of like video game companies, that's less often because, you know, they'll be working on one project for a chunk of time and they only hire out to artists for concept art for like a little while. So yeah, it just depends. But I've worked for a lot of places multiple times, like Bungie's one of those, and there's other ones too. But What is this terrible song?
Dan said about, you know, getting paid to watch me cook. He said, furiously beating eggs. Do you think that would work?
Yes.
Maybe I should start an OnlyFans for cooking. Mihai says the same thing with a dad sneeze scream that you can hear across two zip codes.
Oh, yeah.
We were
It's my dad, like, every time.
No, where did we just go? We were in a parking lot, and we were getting in the car. And I think I've just been like on so low sleep and just like on my last bit of patience. I got so upset. This guy across the parking lot sneezed and like screamed. And I like said, so I was like, God, what the fuck does he have? Like, seriously, does he have to do that? I got so mad. Why does every old man have to fucking yell when they sneeze? And I was really just mad because I haven't slept that much.
Yeah, it's very much a dad thing. My dad used to scream when he sneezed and scare the shit out of you.
Oh no. Asaeus Bunnus says, I thought that was about to be the honey I shit the sheet story. Yeah, well.
That's another one.
When you jumped out. You screamed.
And then you Well, I woke up. I leapt out of bed and I went, "Don't move!" They came like a police officer. Like I had Kim under arrest. And he said, "Don't move!"
Because I leaned over to check if you were okay. Because you jumped out of bed and went, "Ah!"
And I said, "I shit the sheets. Don't move."
You yelled at me.
I was trying to save your life. You almost died. So can you imagine if you put your hand and shit on the bed?
No. And I love that you were so genuinely scared for me. Like, we didn't even, like, it's so funny thinking back to it, but it wasn't funny, like, right at that moment. Like, you were genuinely scared.
It was pretty funny.
It took, like, it just took a beat. Then we were like, what the fuck? And we just started cracking up.
Well, I was just, like, so sick that I couldn't control my body.
Oh, you jumped out of bed so fast and yelled.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he's done that too, but it's all right. We all have our shitting the bed stories, you know?
Don't move! I shit in the bed! You can't give me all your money.
Please! Oh my god. Dave is really embracing his inner exorcist. What is that? Maybe oh, because you're possessed in your sleep.
Sure.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. Terrifying. Imagine it. Oh, no. And Dan says, the joke was, what do you get when you cross a mentally ill loner with a society that abandons him and treats him like trash?
You're just reading that without any context. Why'd you read that?
This is the joke. I was saying I couldn't remember the joke that you told me when you woke up from your dream or whatever it was. And Dan said the joke was, what do you get when you cross a mentally ill loner with a society that abandons him and treats him like trash?
No.
That's all I was doing. I was just reading it.
Okay. I was like, that's like a old thing we were talking about.
Dan said the joke inspired millions, and they said it's too real, Dan. Oh, Riley's doing Riley Easter, because I saw both Rileys are here. Riley Easter is doing a Garfield comic right now.
Oh, beautiful. Yeah, Riley's been crushing it with his comics.
I know. Congrats, Riley.
If all you patron piggies haven't seen that.
Or anybody.
Look it up.
Any of you.
Yeah, any of you but the people who know Riley.
Dan says a Tinder girl told him that he sounded like sexy Garfield after she came.
That's pretty good.
So stupid. Wade Alma says, I have no idea how much you make per piece, but how many projects do you have to do?
In general?
I guess so.
Right now, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I have six. Six projects.
Ongoing right now.
Ongoing.
Mm-hmm, which doesn't mean that it's not a piece.
Like, no, they each have like very different chunks of art.
Yeah. Like one is a concept. So that's like lots of concepts, mm-hmm. not just one piece. And then, but not as like rendered, right?
Yeah. There are different styles and things. Like I try to vary up work a lot.
And then some of the other ones are just like, I don't know, like more of a reference images and.
Well, most of them are illustrations, but. Mm-hmm.
But they're all different. I mean, just.
Yeah, they're just all different.
So dire for poo in the bed. That plant looks pretty nutritious, to be honest. 9 out of 10 would maybe eat.
Thanks.
It looks like it would smell really good. Dan said, wow, am I the only one of us who's seen the Joker? Dan is quoting the Joker because he's broken. How many hours do you often dedicate to art each day? It's a work day.
Yeah,
that's what you mean.
Kind of like a regular work day.
If you're talking about art for himself, it's not something that you really dedicate. You kind of like use your work time as that practice time.
Yeah. Too. I work, let's see.
You work
like 8 hours and then maybe a couple hours at night if I have to.
Mm-hmm.
So at the most, maybe like 12 hours.
Mm-hmm. Did you really count it? You're just pretending to count.
I was just trying to think. Like, what do I actually do?
Would you rather make a witch noise or a Joker laugh when you orgasm?
Well, I mean, witch noise. Definitely
what
a witch noise.
How does the Joker laugh?
It depends which Joker you're talking about.
Give me your favorite.
I'm not going to laugh like the Joker. I'd have to practice it.
Okay.
Dan can do it. Dan can do a version of the Mark Hamill Joker laugh.
Okay, Dan, do it in the chat. Let me hear.
Yeah. That's something I'd have to rehearse.
I always like doing would you rathers because I love hearing someone's reasoning for something. Just like that's my favorite part is just hearing why you think something is important or not important. Mm-hmm. So why a witch noise?
I just feel like the Joker laugh wouldn't be funny.
Do you think it would just be scary?
No, it'd just be like cringy. I'd feel like I would like.
You would feel like that like guy who drives that Jeep.
Like a witch laugh is weird. A Joker laugh, I could be like a kid who grew up going to like Hot Topic, and like I think that that's crazy. Like I could like be a total dork doing that and like be like, you know, like this is really gonna be funny.
Okay, but that's it's funnier to think of this as a question for a guy because typically guys only orgasm one time, right? So then for a girl, if they're doing a witch cackle every time they orgasm, that's like, it's not just a one-time thing. They're constantly like, if you're good at it, they're constantly like laughing like a witch. Is that what that means?
I guess so,
because yeah. How do you apply that to a girl? That would be... I would take the Joker laugh if that's the case, because then doing it once is a little stupid, but doing it multiple times is amazing.
If I had to hear the Mark Hamill Joker laugh a bunch of times, I don't know if I could do it.
All of a sudden, just going to be bad.
Just be this face.
Yeah. How do you determine how much to charge, or do they give you a price on the project?
Well, it changes depending on your level where you're at. So, you know, that... I mean, also time changes that, like inflation, all that shit, like how much people are willing to pay out, that changes over time. But if it's for like a client that has set rates or something like that, then you don't really do that. So if you're working for like a Wizards of the Coast or Hasbro or something, then, you know, that's not a consideration. But if you're working for a video game company, I would ask around for people who already work there. And just be like, what? Like, I like message them and be like, you know, I'm getting approached by this company. What's a fair rate? You know, what do you charge? If you're comfortable asking somebody like that, if they're a friend, or just tell them like how much you're going to ask for, and just be like, is that too low? I don't want to bring everybody down. Like, it's very important to kind of check in with other artists and just stay on top of things. Between people who are all working on similar stuff, so that you're not, you know, undercutting everybody else or overcharging and losing the job for sure.
Mm-hmm. I'm laughing because Dan said, I'm worried about your safety, Kim. Even for Dave, the amount of wicked grins he's been drawing lately seems high. And I had a look again. I was like, oh no, that wizard is wickedly grinning at us. Mm-hmm. And then Dan also did the impression of the laugh in the chat, if you want to go ahead and with the note being guttural. A hoo hoo hee hee. Do you have any tips for people with bad wrists that are wanting to get into the industry?
I guess it depends on what that means.
Are they broken?
Yeah, are they like totally bad? Do you get carpal tunnel easily? Like what is it about your wrist? Do you have arthritis? Like what's happening? That changes everything, because if you're just talking about like you get issues when you draw a lot, mm-hmm. then stretch.
Yeah.
Then do this sort of thing, like pull your, you know, arm out straight, pull your fingers back, same with your thumb, do individual fingers like that. And then take your hand, bend it down, put your thumb here, and your hand on the other side, and then just bend with your arm out straight. Do that like every hour. Usually helps. I mean, it's pretty generic, but yeah, it depends how severe you're talking.
If it's because you're an avid baller, you might be... out of luck.
Yeah, you might have to stop.
You might have to give up art
the game that you want
and go for basketball.
Yeah.
How, Riley Spalding says, how was your experience living in Colorado? I'm looking for a new state to live in this year, and I've been thinking about moving there. You and everybody else.
There's pros and cons for sure. On the plus side, great weather, easy winter. You know, you have four seasons, but they're not intense. So you're never like destroyed by humidity in the summer, mm-hmm. or, you know, annihilated by like blizzards all winter. Like that's kind of what happens in the East Coast, like mm-hmm. around Boston area where I grew up. And it's way calmer than that. And then there's no bugs. There's like barely any bugs. Mm-hmm. That's amazing. So like you can just be out having a cookout with like your window open and the door open. And you're just not worried about a million mosquitoes getting in your house. That's pretty great. And then on the negative, very flat in most places and brown, like just kind of like
dry
dead grass. The climate
here is mostly high desert.
Yeah.
So there's not a lot of trees. And when we do have trees, it's like they still don't get very big because I think it's because of the elevation. I don't remember what we learned, but it's like the air is definitely thinner. So the trees aren't as nourished and it's also very dry.
There's just not as much water.
Mm-hmm. There's lots of outdoor stuff to do here.
Yeah, that's the other plus. There's tons of like, mm-hmm. like if you're into like rock climbing, there's like rock climbing gyms. If you're into jiu-jitsu or something like that, there's some really amazing gyms here.
Mm-hmm.
If you're into like mountain biking in the mountains, that's everywhere.
There's lots of good food here. Lots of good food here. I feel like we're still finding some new places that are like really good. Place that we just went to that we were like, oh, this is one of our new favorites. So always good places to eat. I think the girls are pretty here if you're moving here by yourself. Like yeah. they're in between. So, you know, like being in the middle of the country, they're not as like, there are very beautiful women here, but they're not generally like LA girls who are like almost all models or actresses or whatever, right? And they're not as casual as like the East Coast. You know, women are a little bit more aggressive on the East Coast, so I feel like they don't like a New York 10 is not the same as an LA 10 is what I've always heard from guys, right? But I feel like middle of the country, very pretty girls if you're looking.
Yeah, and then there's
lots of diversity.
If you're leaving a gang where you come from and you want to join a gang, they got gangs. You could join.
There's lots of gangs here. Yeah, that's true.
You could join a gang.
I could put you in touch with somebody. Yeah. I've only ever lived in Colorado and I really enjoy it. I think especially because I never experienced it the way you do when you're like, I want to live here. I just happen to live here and my parents kind of happen to stay together. So when Dave moved out here, I wanted to like show him a lot of Colorado just because it was like all new and I wanted him to feel very comfortable. And I was like experiencing things for the first time with him. So yeah, I mean, I like it. There's lots of stuff that I like about other places too, though. So it depends on what you want. Ryan DeHoff said, sorry, I'm sure you've been asked. Worried about AI? Yes, he has been asked.
I will say, personally, no. I'm not worried about it. I'm more worried about it for entry-level jobs for artists getting started. I don't want people to be boxed out of having a career or feeling like they can't because of it. I still say that ideation and, you know, like especially a game job where you're working on concepts constantly, AI is not going to replace that. It's just too much. It's too specific. There's too many things you have to do. Too much variety of ideas. It's just, yeah, it won't replace that.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, there's definitely concerns if you're looking to make a career out of doing art, you know, especially like just your motivation. I feel like I could easily see young artists getting like crushed by it.
Mm-hmm.
Just feeling like, what's the point?
Alex says, did you ever do line art on a non-display tablet?
Yeah, for most of my career, I used Intuos.
Yeah, actually, you used that up until the end of 2014 or 2015, something like that.
I kind of started using it when I got that, right around when I got that Logan job working on that movie poster. That was right around when I really started using the tablet a lot.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Yeah, I think 2015, right?
Something like that.
Yeah, because you were already using it, you were still using it when we started dating. And,
yeah.
You know. man, it's been a long time. Kim, would you rather move out to Canada or Mexico, and why? Oh, that's hard. Probably Canada.
Canada, right?
Yeah, I mean, Mexico is beautiful. It has, beaches and warm weather, good food, but it also has the cartel. So I wouldn't want that risk, only because I have small children.
I mean, yeah, I'm sure there's plenty of safe places, but I think in general for familiarity and everything, it's Canada's easier.
Canada's probably the most similar to what I know now. Yeah, that's true. I wouldn't have to learn a new language.
Yeah,
I could,
that's
yeah.
More what I mean. That's
number one, probably. Dave, have you ever had issues with non-paying clients? Do you have any recourse?
I'd say if I ever had issues with that, it was all due to a lack of planning on my part. So that maybe happened to me in the very beginning, but I quickly navigated that by changing up how I get paid, half up front, half upon completion, and I don't send you any files until you send me the rest of the payment. That's generally how it worked when I was working freelance for random clients. And the only time that's happened to me with actual established businesses was White Wolf, the RPG company. They didn't pay me for upwards of a year and change or something like that. It was a long time, and I had a lot of back and forth with them, and they it's not reflective on their entire company, but the AD I was working with, after I told him I was pissed, he basically said to me that I should be lucky to have a job working on a thing, and I just went, oh, okay, I'll never work for you again ever in my life. You just lost all of my business forever. Mm-hmm. So that was the end of that. But yeah, they took forever paying me.
Alma says, that diss in East Coast Girls, what did I do to you, Kim? I wasn't trying to diss them. I was saying that they are more confident, so they don't spend as much time worrying about other people's opinions.
It depends on how much you like aggressive accents.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think that they're not beautiful women on the East Coast. I just think that they're not looking for approval in the same ways that some people are. Not that everyone's doing it for approval, but I think that they just have a different level of confidence because they're not always trying to prove themselves, because they're not going into castings and rehearsals and getting let down over and over. You know what I mean? It's a different mentality when you're Hollywood and they're telling you that you need to be this and this and this and always concerned about your looks. It's different when you're just beautiful but you're not fighting that, you know, because then you're just it's that society standard of what beauty should be. A lot of that is in LA because that's where, you know, we get our idea of beauty with the models and the actresses and everything there. Riley Spalding says, I'm moving out from way northern Washington. I'm also down to move anywhere in the States. How is it on the East Coast? I love the East Coast.
If you're into, cold weather, hot summers, you mm-hmm. don't care about that stuff, then yeah, the East Coast is beautiful. I love the Northeast.
Mm-hmm.
It's my favorite people, my favorite look of an environment.
Mm-hmm, same.
I just like the you know, like even just going downtown Boston, like seeing the older parts of the city and just how much variety there is and like food and yeah, it's just a lot there.
It's also because everything's so condensed, like you see a lot of people and it feels very alive.
Yeah, there's a lot of people out all the time.
Even if the population is like maybe smaller in some of the, you know, surrounding cities of Boston, like to be specific, there's still tons of people out because it's so condensed.
Mm-hmm.
It's just very much alive. And yeah, you can drive to like different states in a couple of hours. We're like, we drove for 6 hours and sometimes you're still in Colorado after 6 hours from like where we live. So,
and to live in like a town outside of Boston, mm-hmm. not like the city itself,
not Boston proper.
Yeah. It's like to live like outside of there, it's actually a lot cheaper than somewhere like Colorado.
Yeah. Cause even we live probably like 30 to 40 minutes outside of downtown Denver and it's super expensive still. It's still expensive. The prices here have been skyrocketing because we have a lot of people from Texas and California moving here. Like lots of people. And a lot of that had to do with like buying up real estate, I think. But also, you know, like droughts and fires and all that other stuff happening in California like over the last couple of years. It's been crazy. So they were saying that I was Dan said that I'm hitting them with the sex tourism because I was talking about how Colorado has like somewhat pretty girls, and Riley said moving somewhere new. Hey Kim, how's the pussy there?
Yeah, I like that you're the one saying all this stuff.
I think that it's funny because it's very disproportionate though. Like, I think that a lot of people would say that the men on the East Coast are like disproportionately attractive to like the amount of women there. I think you told me that, that the guys are really handsome in Boston specifically.
Yeah, that's what I said. That's why they call it Beam Town. The boys of the beans. And so you get them. You gotta go there for the boys.
Yeah.
Stay for the lobster.
There you go.
Visit for the boys.
Dan says, as an outsider, Colorado pros. Good food, cool nature, mild climate, nice people. And then the cons. High suicide rate. That's not what I was thinking I was gonna read. I thought I was gonna read altitude, so it threw me off. Oh my god, high suicide rate. I don't know why that was the first thing on your list, Dan. When has that ever... Have you felt like committing suicide when you come to Colorado? Reverse claustrophobia? Oh yeah, it feels empty. That's called Uno reverse claustrophobia. Let's see, it says poison snakes. What? Don't you guys have poisonous snakes in Massachusetts?
Yes.
What?
Yes, there's poisonous snakes okay. in Massachusetts.
And every town is identical. Oh, not every town.
It depends where you go.
There's a lot of similarity.
You gotta go
here.
To the towns that like aren't the ones that they just built.
You have to
like ones that were here naturally.
Right. You have to keep in mind that Colorado really only exists because it's high desert. You can't like farm and crop here. Like people couldn't do that really before. It exists because people came here for mining. Right. Like there are miners that settled here and they wanted to settle along the mountain. That's it. It's like, this isn't a great place, you know, to have plants and crops and farm and all of that other stuff. It was just for gold. And so like, there was so much that was built out of efficiency rather than out of beauty, where like you go to the Northeast and there's so much character and it's so beautiful.
What's that Wade one?
Well, hold on, I'm still catching up. let's see, Dead Man's Pixels, heavy question, but do you think there's a point in life or age when trying to pursue a career in art is just a dream and it's time to face reality? Like, you stop seeing progress in your art too?
No, I don't think so. I think, like, it depends on what you're doing with it. It depends on, you know, like, if you're 80 and you want to make a career as, like, a full-time video game artist, like, working on everything, mm-hmm. it's probably too late. Because how are you going to do that? It's like, it takes a chunk of time. Like, I feel like even me going, like, as hard as I went in the beginning, like, just trying to get better, it still took me, like, 5 years minimum to make something of myself. And then after that, like, I didn't feel great about what I was doing for another, like, 8 years or whatever. It's like, so it is weird. Like, it does, it's, and then that never stops. That goalpost always moves. It's not like a thing where, it's not a job where you get to a place and you go, I made it, I'm done, I'm the artist now. That doesn't happen. You continually grow forever. You just are always improving and, you know, changing as an artist. If you're like actively trying, then you're always growing and you're never really at the end of whatever you're doing. That never happens. So I don't know. I think, like, it's never too late in the sense where you could always be at some level of progress along that path. It's not like, you know, you're either at this end or you're not. It's like, no, there's a whole variety of artists. And it depends on what you want to be. If you want to be like a realist painter that can replicate what like a camera can produce, it's like, I don't know. Like, that'll take longer than if you want to just do, you know, Splatoon artwork.
Yeah.
Or draw Mario or something, or just come up with cool ideas for games. You don't even need to be like incredible as an artist to come up with great ideas for concepts for games. Like, plenty of concept artists aren't super efficient like realist painters or comic artists or something majorly successful outside of what they do in concept art. So I don't think you need to put like unreasonable pressure on yourself to be everything to everybody. You can do one thing really well that isn't this super demanding task and have a successful career.
Mm-hmm. Eric says, do you have an example you can point to for what would represent a perfect portfolio piece? As an example we can refer to when building our own body of work.
No, not in terms of like a perfect, like, is there a perfect portfolio? Depends what you're going for. What do you want to do? It's because a perfect portfolio is all in context. What's a perfect portfolio for working on, you know, Batman Beyond animated series?
Right.
What is that versus a perfect portfolio for working on the new Age of Empires video game? Like, I'm gonna work on, you know, Hades. Mm-hmm. What's a perfect portfolio for that? Each one of these things has a different set of needs. So you change your portfolio dependent on where you're aiming.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. It's, I don't know. It's like saying there's a perfect outfit for every occasion or something. It's like, I don't know if you're going to go to the White House with like Crocs and swim trunks on and a tank top and be let in to see the president. Like, I don't, there's different things you need to do. It's like, mm-hmm. every job is different.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. Longbox says, your anatomy and biology is insane. The way you structure your creations flow so naturally. Truly captivated watching you work. It's very nice.
Thanks. Just trying to figure stuff out. This is actually like my comfort zone, is drawing plants. I can do this without thinking. Makes me happy.
Rexon says, how many hours do you take just for learning fundamentals each day?
Right now, I do it while I work. So, yeah, that's that. But starting out, I spent, you know, for the first, like, few years, getting into art at least 2 hours a day.
Mm-hmm.
That was my goal, was 2 hours a day. And I always tried to hit it. And even if I didn't hit 2 hours, I'd get an hour and a half.
You get close.
Whatever. I just had that goal. So at least I did that.
Yeah. Longbox also said, would love to see you do some work on Spawn.
I've done a couple things on the Patreon for Spawn, but I've never worked on it officially. I know some writers who worked on Spawn who were like, do you want to do covers? And then I just couldn't do them at the time.
Dan's saying to Riley to come live on his third floor for a week and explore NYC and Boston. And Riley said, for real?
Yeah, Dan would let you do that.
Dan is definitely the person who would do that. This is why he has crazy stories, is because he's willing to...
I know, if you're wondering why Dan has weird stories about... Yeah. It's like because he just invites people he doesn't know to come live at his house.
Yeah, for a week.
And then eventually you'll be one of the stories from the stream. I'm not going to say his name, but this guy came and stayed with me once.
Just don't do anything weird, Riley, because we're going to hear about
it. he ate his toenails.
He woke me up laughing.
He was standing above my bed when I slept. He was watching me sleep.
I mean, he bought his own groceries, but he ate the mayonnaise out of the jar.
But he ate all my food.
With a spoon.
And left his groceries in there. And then he said, trust me, you'll love it.
I would love to hear a story about Riley. He brought home men, women, stray dogs.
He found a dead coyote on the road. He went, Dan, I found this outside. And Dan went, of course you did.
We need to pray.
Yeah.
And he brought it to the altar. That is Dan's upstairs.
Yeah, where's your shovel? Why? I killed your neighbor's dog. We gotta hide it before morning.
Asaspada says, can confirm, I'm a guy on the East Coast and I'm pretty damn attractive. I mean, so is Dave. He was a guy on the East Coast. And look how beautiful he is.
You can't deny it.
You're beautiful.
They call me the pale horse.
Alma says, if you are drawing with a purpose, are you using references? What is your art goal? Are you drawing every day or once a month? Is it all the same subject? There's many variables. I think that they're talking about...
Yeah, to them.
Yes. I just thought it was a question for you.
Ron Burgundy.
Yeah. No. I saw question marks. Looked like it was a question for you. And don't lie to me. Boston is just 65% Bill Burr. There are a lot of... I would say like 10% Bill Burr.
No, there's a lot more Bill Burr than that.
25.
Anybody who's like working class people, there's a lot of Bill Burr dudes.
Yeah, but...
Think of my cousin.
Oh, I thought...
Think of Joe.
Yeah, but I was thinking like he just meant like looks.
No, he's talking about like...
Personality?
That attitude.
Yeah, that's like 90%.
Yeah.
Duh, Joe. Oh my god. Oh, that was funny. I don't know. I'm behind. Dan said, yes, Kim, I have. And I don't know what that's about.
That's why you just gotta read regular chat. You don't have to go back and fish.
Okay, sorry if I missed your question. I was trying to be Ron Burgundy.
I'd rather not have to figure out what we're talking about in the moment.
Okay, Fuzzy asks, Dave, how would you salvage this picture if your line art was on the sketch layer?
It'd be pretty easy. The sketch in the background's a yellow color, so all I would do is just go into Photoshop and find the, do like hue saturation, isolate it to like a yellow and red color and just lighten it all the way and desaturate it all the way. So anything that is left behind is just merged with the black line.
Nice.
It's pretty easy. And you can do the same thing with like selective color as well if it doesn't get enough of it out. But yeah, that's partially the reason I color the lines there, is just so that it's clearly legible from like the rest of what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm. Rye Guts says, I'm actually visiting Colorado next month. Girlfriend and I are going to see if it's for us. We've been in NYC for 10 years and are absolutely done with it. It's definitely different. It's not walkable. You have to drive everywhere. I know there's some parts of New York that are like that too, but...
Yeah. Yeah, it's going to be a lot of driving.
A lot of driving. That's the biggest difference coming from like those condensed like, cities and
I would
all
say
that
this.
Stuff. Like, everything's very spread out here.
Where I grew up, I used to live like 45 minutes from Boston, basically. And that was the drive into Boston. And Boston was like the faraway places mm-hmm. where I grew up. And everything else was within 15, 20 minutes mm-hmm. if it was far. Here, so much stuff is like 45 minutes away, no matter where you are around Denver. Like mm-hmm. stuff's so spread out mm-hmm. that you have to travel to get places. Mm-hmm. You know, like if there's someplace that's not in your immediate town, you're kind of driving a half hour.
My parents live about 45 minutes from us. And the conversation is always, did you guys get snow over there? As if we live in a different state. And I'm like, we're not that far apart, but it does feel like it because it is quite a drive. Yeah. Dan's life is never boring. That's true. Dave, Dan, and Kim. Can't thank you all enough for all the amazing art and generous tutorials. If you ever find yourselves in Chicago, happy to show you around. I definitely want to go to Chicago because I hear that the food there is also delicious.
Yeah, I've only been there in like a just getting onto a plane.
Like, yeah, same. Just connecting. Yeah, we've only had like
I've always wanted to go. And I lived in Peoria for like a few months. And Peoria, oh... I don't envy anybody who stayed there.
Dan said he ate my food and left all his groceries there. Literally what Kim did the last time they visited. I still have Chinese rib sauce. I cooked food for you, Dan, and this is how you thank me. I give you extra ingredients. I gave Dan some delicious ingredients. I made him cookies. And that's the thanks I get? Oliver says, I just wanted to tell Dave he's been a real inspiration to me. I started painting and drawing after seeing his art. Thank you, man.
Hey, thank you. I'm glad that you got something out of hanging around looking at my goblins.
I don't know what this is, but I'm going to read it. Single Latina artist willing to live abroad as digital nomad. Any bold, adventurous soul available here? I like using the chat as a way to hook up with someone.
Yeah, this is just like finding couch surfing.
Yeah. Like the hustle. This person in a stream.
It's
in a
the
drawing
way to do
stream.
It.
I love it.
That really is the way to do it. Is I say the same thing with like freelance or anything. It's let people know. Let them know you're looking.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only way to get some traction.
How else do you think people know?
Yeah. Nobody's going to know what you're after.
Mm-hmm.
You got to let them know what you're after.
Tell them what you want.
Say it with your chest.
Porfirio says, I know you don't use Procreate, but have you tested out your Photoshop brushes on it? I recently learned that you can use Photoshop brushes in Procreate.
I have not.
I thought you tried that tip recently, that new, like, fine.
That's different.
Procreate? Isn't Procreate on the iPad?
Yeah, but that's a physical tip that I added to my Procreate pen. They're talking about like brushes that you can bring from Photoshop.
I understand, but I'm saying I thought you used that recently.
Oh yeah, but only for like a second, and I didn't use Procreate. I used Clip Studio when I used the tablet.
Oh, I didn't know you clip on the iPad.
Yeah, like
oh, okay.
I still think like, I still think Procreate's better. I mean, Clip Studio's better than Procreate on the tablet. Like,
yeah.
The brush engine. Like, yeah. I can't get over the accuracy versus, it's like you can actually make comics on Clip Studio on the tablet.
When you wrote your comic, did you plan out the story chapter by chapter, or did you just say, fuck it, and write whatever you felt like and that sounded cool all the time?
Well, it went like this. Like, Dan's in the chat here, and he wrote Steve with me, and we did, like, the whole comic together. But the way we did it was we would kind of come up with, like, a premise for an issue and then just riff on it on the phone, and we just... You know, we do the character voices, we do everything, and we just kind of improvise a whole lot of it and then structure it all together after that. So there's like a inkling of an idea, and then you just expound upon that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty much how it always went. And then we lay everything out in spreadsheets and average page counts that we're kind of thinking we're going to get to when we execute it into a comic. So there's a lot of planning. But we try to keep it spontaneous. That's why the whole thing's like improvised and then edited, because we at least want like that energy to come across in the comic, that it's a real conversation rather than, you know, either one of us just in our own head typing dialogue. It's like typing dialogue. It just doesn't feel the same as like performing it, like actually saying the things to make it feel natural. It's very hard to write natural dialogue. At least it is for, you know, for us. That's like a harder skill.
And when he says us, he means him and Dan.
Yeah.
Please keep talking about how far away everything is in Colorado. It's so exciting. In Brooklyn, it feels like I could punch a hole in my apartment wall and see my neighbor taking a shower. Well, okay, so here's the thing.
That's the real problem with Colorado, is that every house is right next to each other.
We call it,
like, why?
We call it spit distance. Yeah, like your houses, they're fairly close together. You don't have like a huge yard. There's not a ton of huge yards here. And when you do have a huge yard here, it's like a tiny yard where you're like in the East Coast, or like where Dave grew up, right? Like in his town, it's like, you could have a small, humble home and still have an acre of land. And that's, like, pretty normal. And here, you pay so much money to have any type of, like, large lot.
Which is hilarious because there's so much
space. Like, you could spread out. But because the population's, like, forever growing, I don't know if they're trying to plan for the future or what they think it is. But anyway, we call it spit distance because you could basically be in your house and spit and it will land on your neighbor's house. But then you have to drive still 30 minutes to go to a fucking store. Like, anything, you know?
Yeah, and if you want a house with, like, a quarter acre, you're paying upwards of, like, $1 million.
Easy. Unless you live out really
you move far
from
Denver.
Really far, yeah. But even then, like, if you live on the western slope of Colorado, where, like, there are, you know, like, not very many big cities, is very small town, and they're all very spread apart. Even houses out there, it's like super flat. There, you can get land, but you're still paying like a decent price. It's not like
You're living in the sticks.
No,
sticks rates.
Well, like, you know, my aunt and uncle, their house is on like I think an acre and a half, and they have a four bedroom, just ranch style house, and I think theirs is like still fairly expensive, like, you know, in comparison to the rest of the country, like over $500,000.
Right.
You know? And they live out in the middle of nowhere. It's like they live in a very small town. Riley Easter, he retracted two messages. I'm not sure what that's about.
Probably racist shit.
Getting angry. Sometimes in art. Sometimes I see an art. Oh my god. Sometimes I see art in comics that I would not be happy with if I made it. But it still works fine in the comic. Any advice on this?
To get over, like, perfection, like in your own comics. It's really just what's the best use of your art? How are you best serving the story? Sometimes having like really beautiful art in a comic, this might sound weird, but if it's in every panel and every panel is very dense with like beautifully drawn stuff, it can almost be a distraction if it's like the whole background's filled out and everything. Whereas like simplifying things, it kind of, there's a nice balance between those two points. It's not like you have to do one or the other, or, you know, one's right and the other's not. But like, there's definitely a point where if the artwork is too flashy, it may or may not be serving the story. Like a funny comic, it's like a, if there's like a really handsome guy doing stand-up comedy, it's not as funny. Like it just isn't. Like you don't have the same connection to the comic. Like, it's hard to really put that, you know, like if you're into stand-up comedy, you know what I'm talking about. But like that same thing applies to really good artwork with like a funny comic. Like you can't really do that. It doesn't work. It's not funny to do that. Like it's funnier to do like the South Park approach and have it be like shitty looking and crude and just kind of like quick, easy. Like look at like Joe Kappa. Like we've talked about him a bunch on streams. Like his videos, like watch Joe Kappa's videos. Look how like simply it's done, and it adds so much to the comedy. So like your artwork needs to service whatever your comic is trying to, like, you know, whatever the comic's trying to accomplish story wise.
Yeah. Well, and like you even started Steve that way, where you were like, the drawings got better progressively, but you were like, the punchline still lands.
Yeah, it needs, but the artwork needs to be crude.
Right, it was like crude because, and it didn't take away from that punchline.
Yeah.
It wasn't distracting, like something that would have been like hyper rendered or whatever. Very beautiful, like you said. Riley says that he has to remind himself that people are not going to get caught up in the art, especially with comedy.
Absolutely. I mean, it's like what I was just saying. There's a whole, like, psychology to it. Like, what people are willing to laugh at.
Well, and you also, like, even though I have a preference for what I like in quotes, you know, art, it's like, I don't think people look at that as, like, the way they would think of art traditionally in their head. I think they look at that as entertainment.
Yeah.
And it's way different because your standards for entertainment is different than your standards for, like, quote, art. Like, what a general public would consume as what they think is art, you know?
Yeah, and you have to think, like, why do people read comics? To look at beautiful artwork? Like, that's an artist thing.
Yeah.
That's you. That's not people. Like, most people don't expect that. Like,
I know.
It's a nice thing in, like, a Marvel comic if the artwork's beautiful, because it can be.
Yeah.
Because it's a different type of story. But if you're doing comedy, it's much funnier to draw shitty stuff. Like, it's like, for instance, on your Sonic the Hedgehog comic where he's going for the gun. It's like,
give me that.
It's funnier if it doesn't look perfect. Like, if Sonic's eyes are a little, like, weird.
Yeah.
Or just something's off about the drawing. Like, it's like another layer to what's funny about it.
Right, like you recognize it still. It's still very recognizable as a character.
Yeah. I mean, just take a, you know, take a page from all the memes. Like, look at, like, every meme where, like, they make fun of people. Like,
funny?
Look at, like, how, you know, like, you've seen those, like, black and white drawings of just, like, the girl like this. It's like, just, like, the head sticking out like E.T., like, eyes on the sides of their heads. Like, yeah, it's just funny and stupid looking.
Also, Riley, if you need a reminder, go look at your comics that have done well already. Like, you should be proud of that. That's like, that is a reminder right there. It's not a one-off thing either. It's happened multiple times for you already. That's a good reminder. Yeah, some dude said that I skipped his question. I didn't skip your question, and thank you. Someone else answered it for me, basically. Yeah, Dave's talked about AI a lot, so I was just trying to not repeat questions, sorry.
Yeah, we've just talked about AI in this video.
Mm-hmm. Dan says, breaking a huge book project down into a spreadsheet with boxes for text, sketches, lines, colors, etc., then ticking all the boxes off makes big projects feel so, so satisfying. Can't recommend enough.
Yeah, it's making something manageable. Mm-hmm. It's that thing of, like, you know what you have to do in a day, but if you don't think of each step it would take to get a difficult thing done, it's harder to start.
Mm-hmm.
But if you break it down into simple steps, you're like, I'm like, that whole thing might be intimidating, but that first step is easy. I can do that. And then I can do the next step. It's like, you know.
But you know what that is? That's ADHD brain being like compartmentalizing. It's that thing that I heard about. You may have ADHD if you clean like this. And it's like, you make piles of stuff and you categorize things. Because that's like, essentially compartmentalizing, you know, like you're taking like small chunks, you're like, okay, now I have this one that goes all the way to the bathroom and this one that needs to go whatever, you know, like these different piles. It's like that. It's like very,
I mean,
like,
it's, that's true, but it's, I think it's also the same way you kind of learn everything. It's like you don't
steps.
Like, yeah, it's like you don't go into a classroom and then they drop the whole semester on you at once. It's like you do it in chunks so that you retain all of it.
Like you basically made a syllabus for yourself, for your schedule. Like, this is by this date, this is what we have.
Because if you knew how many assignments you had for like that whole semester, like it would be intimidating. Like, God, I have to do all that.
Yeah. Yeah, I can see that. Kyle said to Riley, I love your Sonic comic. That's a hard thing to say. I showed it to my friend and he said, why would Sonic need a gun?
What do you mean?
Kyle, your friend sounds like a loser. Dan,
that's like, why doesn't Winnie the Pooh have pants?
Yeah, like, is your friend a huge dork? Because he sounds like one.
Yeah, you should have pushed him and said, what are you, a dork? I'm gonna beat you up, dude. Give me your money.
Get out of here, goof.
How much money do you have on you, dude? You don't need it. You're not going anywhere in life. Give me it.
Why would Sonic need a gun?
Ugh. I need to buy more money with it. Give me your money.
Dan says, the most universally recognized face is the smiley emoji. The more you render a character, the more audiences you lose, especially with comedy.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's the thing of... we've talked about that a lot, but it's the... you know, understanding comics book.
Mm-hmm.
Basically that people relate to a character the more, yeah, well, that's probably the wrong word. People relate to a character that has less detail.
Yeah.
It's like the more vague they are.
Right?
Yeah. The more vague, the more a person can put themselves into that character and be like, oh, that's me.
Mm-hmm.
The more you define the characteristics of that character, the more it becomes a very specific person that only one person can relate to.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, depends on your goal with the project. That's why Steve is like a skeleton. He's like a good person for that because he could be anybody. We're all skeletons.
Mm-hmm.
That's the idea.
I like that. Super says, why were you so inactive on social media for almost 10 years? You didn't. Were you so inactive?
Never.
I was just going to say, I'm like, what?
I'm like super active. I've posted probably every 3 days at the least.
I thought for like maybe 17 years. I know. I was like, maybe like the 10 years before you met me, but you've always used some form of social media, haven't you?
Yes, absolutely. Unless you're strictly talking about Facebook. Facebook sucks. And the only reason...
That's true.
The only reason...
That's funny. That's how you know this person came here from Facebook.
Yeah, the only reason you know I'm doing this right now is because you saw my thing that I can't shut off. I don't know how to shut off the Instagram story share to
that's
Facebook.
That's so funny.
But that's it. That's the reason. So just go to my Twitter or my Instagram. I've been posting there almost every day for those 10 years.
I'm like, what? Oh, that's so funny. Riley says, I appreciate the advice, guys. Thanks again for the kind words.
course, dude.
I like to be supportive of our friends.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, if it's the best, I mean, honestly, like, we didn't do anything besides just be like, that was cool what you did. Like, you did it. But the idea is that, like, anybody who's part of, like, the Patreon group that's been doing all the challenges and stuff, it's like, to see anybody that you see often succeed in some way like that, it's like, yes. Mm-hmm. Like, absolutely. It's like, that's the whole dream of this, is to find yourself in whatever you do. It's like, it's amazing when that clicks. And you're definitely doing it. Like, you found a lane. Like, utilizing your strengths.
Yeah. And I think that, like, when we've done these challenges in the past, and we've talked about, like, we like this about, you know, someone's art, or we're like, we start to get to know you guys in a more personal level. We're like, we know what some of your strengths are because you have such distinct personalities. And I think that, like, seeing it shine is very nice.
Absolutely.
Because, like, I mean, Riley's in the chat all the time. Riley's in the Discord all the time. And it's like, you're a very active member of this, like, community. And so it's like, I'm sure other people see it too. They talk to you. And it's really nice because then, you know, we see your art and we see that you're taking it very seriously. But then we see you in the chat being funny. And we're like, that's a strength, you know?
Yeah, it's like you're playing a shooter, but you're never using your shotgun.
Yeah.
It's like you have this really powerful weapon, and you just are like, I don't even know what to do with that.
Yeah.
Like, I just use this handgun.
And you're like,
this is what I use.
But I want to be taken seriously.
Serious guys use a handgun. They don't use that shotgun. Yeah, everybody likes the shotgun. Yeah. I just don't touch it.
Yeah.
It's like... Like, that's how you gotta think of your strengths. It's like, use everything you got.
And when you have that, to start, you know, building a name for yourself, and you're also working on your serious art, in quotes, you can do both. There's no reason you can't do both. But if you gain more followers and you get an audience from doing something that you are strong or good at, do it, you know? Dave always tells me, he's like, you should have started an OnlyFans.
Yeah.
Like, exploit your strengths is what I'm saying. Don't let anybody else exploit you. You do it. You exploit your strengths.
I know. When you see the numbers people put out for OnlyFans, it's like, God, I wish.
Like 300,000 a month or something.
Like, I wish I had anything that I could offer to OnlyFans. Like, if I could just show my asshole to crowds, get 300,000 a month and just cut out all the bullshit and just buy a house. Because that's all I care about.
No.
That's all I care about. I don't give a shit.
You do have a beautiful asshole.
Thanks.
You
should.
Kyle said, I said, obviously to protect what's his. That's why Sonic needs a gun.
That's true. You know what scene I watched that didn't age as well as I thought it would? There's this movie called The History of Violence with Viggo Mortensen. And there's the diner scene. It's like the moment that kicks off the drama. Mm-hmm. Where, like, these two guys come into this diner to rob it. And they find out that, like, oh, this guy who works at the diner, Viggo, like, he's not actually just this guy who's a small town dude. He's like a witness protection guy who's like this secret killer. And he, like, you know, stops this robbery at the diner from these two bad dudes. But it was so corny, like, watching it again. And I was like, man, like, it's crazy what age does. Like, movies just change so much, and, like, tone and everything. It's like
awareness of how, like, people actually talk versus, like,
yeah, like, when you're a kid, like, when I was a kid and I saw History of Violence in that scene, I was like, that's awesome. And I watched it again and I was like,
let down.
I was like, this isn't that cool.
Oh, that sucks. That ruined your memory of it.
It's like watching the Ewok Adventure after growing up and being like, this fucking sucks. When I was a kid, it was the coolest shit ever, and I watched it every day. And then I told, like, every one of our friends, you gotta come over for sandwich night. We're all gonna eat sandwiches. We're gonna have desserts. And like 30 people came to this one. It was like packed full of people in this tiny basement. And we made them watch the Ewok adventure movies. And it was just a bunch of grown, well, like 18-year-olds. Like, and then like people in their 20s and a couple people in their 30s. So it's like no kids are there. And we just put it on and it just went. And we're just like, oh, I'm so sorry. Like, this is so bad. Like, we can't. There can't be this many people in silence watching the Ewok adventure eating sandwiches. This is insane. No, it's not even just that. The sandwich night was ritualistic. Like, we said a prayer. We held hands in a big circle and did a sandwich prayer together.
Oh, my God.
Everybody loved sandwich night. It was like a miracle. And, we had like a... It rotated between people, like, who was there. You had to, like, everybody had a spotlight moment in the prayer where they had to say what they're grateful for.
Oh, my God.
And we did it every week. It was so much fun.
That's insane.
It was very funny.
I love it.
It's almost as good as Taco Tuesday. Taco Tuesday was inviting everybody we knew for tacos, and everybody came over. So many people, and me and my friend Dave, we just bought like 8 gallons of milk and every variation of cookie that was available, and we got 0 tacos, and we just made this huge platter table of like plates with like towers of cookies.
Stupid.
And just everybody skipped dinner and came to this, and it was just mountains of cookies and every kind
so
of milk you can imagine.
Stupid.
So fucking dumb. And everybody was so mad. It was worth it, though.
I like it.
That man, that fucking Caravan of Courage. I think that's the name of it. That movie stinks.
Jose Espandez says, I just had a conversation about Winnie the Pooh's pants and how he's Winnie the Pooh and not Winnie the Bear. That's true. Why is he Winnie the Pooh?
It's cool.
Bear.
Have you ever read the books?
Yeah, I have, actually. The ones we have.
It's like the books, I feel like, are actually pretty funny. Or just like, they're like the right kind of lighthearted. They're great.
I love the little song. Do you know which one I'm talking
Tiddly
about?
Pong.
Yeah. You know exactly which one. I just read that the other night to Axe, and I was like, oh my God, this is so cute. And I feel like that's, you can totally see his character, like that little voice, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Even though I know that didn't come until after the books, but.
Yeah, that's when I work on my Winnie the Pooh voice, reading that story.
Oh, Father. Oh, Father.
How do you do it? Tiddly pom. How does it go? I was doing it so good.
Oh,
maybe I can't do it with this music in my.
Oh, how it goes, tiddly pom. Oh, how it snows, tiddly pom.
It's really good though. That the actual books are great.
Mm-hmm. They're very cute. Hi Dave, how do you manage to do different styles? Whenever I try to deviate from my default style, fantasy style, I keep going back to old habits and end up making an art style abomination. I can do anime style and painterly realistic style, but I can't seem to be able to combine both like the way you do in your Capcom anime stuff. Any tips would be really helpful. Thank you in advance.
Well, it's funny because I don't feel like I'm that great at that. Like, I try, and I've gotten better recently. Like, I've had a few successes in that, but it's really just doing it a lot and constantly being like critical of like, why didn't that work? Like, what's wrong with this? Is it just the drawing? Like, why am I messing this up as bad as I am? And like, for the longest time, I always saw comments of people being like, this isn't that great. Like, why do the faces look like this? Stuff like that. And I'm like, I agree. Like, I don't know what I'm doing wrong. I have to figure it out. So it's just repetition, practicing a lot. That's really it. Because it's like, if you don't do that stuff all the time, like, I don't do that all the time. So I have to kind of reorient my brain to like think about that stuff. Like, every time I start a project like that, like the Ginyu Force thing I did.
Curtis says, I've been following since the Steve Volume 2 released and has been a real inspiration to me in my artwork now, especially with skeletons and bones. I'm a tattoo apprentice and ref it any chance I can. Thank you. It's very kind of you.
No, thank you.
I know, however many skeletons he's had to draw, it's like you get every angle of a skeleton that you could possibly need for reference. Doing like the weirdest shit. Alex says, hey Dave, why did you pick YouTube to do streams? Have you thought of using Twitch?
We have a Twitch channel. I just haven't really hopped back on there. It was just easier to do YouTube for some reason. I can't remember why.
Dan asked, did OnlyFans even exist before you guys met? No, it didn't.
No, it didn't.
Everyone's talking about your asshole.
I wish that was like... I wish you were like my handler or something. Like I was wearing a suit and like before a debate.
Everyone's saying, there's a market for everything. The internet has an insatiable appetite for butt pics. It's never too late, Dave. And they're archiving me telling you that you have a beautiful asshole.
It's fine. It's not a secret.
It's not a secret. I talk about it. I think I've described it in detail. At least to one person, maybe not on a stream. Felix said, hey, Dave, do you prefer to be paid by the hour or day?
Day.
Riley says, all I think about with that movie is Viggo 69ing his wife on the stairs, and that's the dream.
That's the best part of that whole movie. That movie, that scene is insane. When I was a kid, I can't remember when it came out, but I saw it in the theater, and I remember sitting through that scene in the theater, and if you know the scene, you know that it goes on for way too long.
Oh no, really?
And it goes on long enough where it's funny. Like, it becomes funny, like, as you're watching it. Like, the beginning, you're like, whoa, this is pretty intense. And then it just doesn't stop, and you're like, what? Because in every other movie you've seen, that like, starts like that, and then it, like, fades to black or goes
like
to
implying,
the next morning or
obviously.
Something happens.
Right.
It's like, but in that movie, they just don't stop. You're just like, whoa. The fuck's going on? Like, it's so weird. Like, not weird in like a I'm uncomfortable with sex kind of way. It's just tonally, it's weird.
Yeah.
She's like wearing a cheerleader uniform.
Hell yeah. I've never seen the movie, so.
It's very funny.
Asaya Espada says, I just had the same feeling when I played Jet Force Gemini for N64. The game fucking sucks, but I thought it was so cool as a kid.
Yeah, exactly. There's so many things like that where you try and get back into a thing that you remember being good. I really think like the only time that works is like music. Like I can listen to old music from when I was a kid and still like it. But man, I have a really hard time with like games and movies that I thought were like Warriors of Virtue is one of those. I remember seeing that in the theater. And it's like the kangaroo kung fu movie. It's a bunch of like mystic kangaroos that
no.
fly through the air and fight. And as a kid, I was like, this is the coolest shit anybody's ever done. Fuck yes. These like Tibetan kangaroos just beating the shit out of stuff and doing wushu. I was like,
so
yes,
stupid.
Absolutely. And then my dad's face, like, you know, God bless my dad. For going to these things. But like his face after those movies, like Warriors of Virtue, he's just like this. Like, that's why my dad made me go to like Casino to like go see like
real
movies.
Movies
that were good.
Your poor dad.
Yeah. I remember it. I've talked about this before, but him coming out of Men in Black and being, that's the worst fucking movie I've ever seen. I was like, I'm so sorry, Dad. I loved it.
Oh. Some dude says, I'm having a hard time drawing shadows and highlights without reference. What is your advice to improve my skills? Light something in front of you. Use the light on your phone.
Yeah, draw real things that have lighting on them. That's all I did.
Different textures, different...
Yep, different textures. Make sure that you have like your shit on your desk, a lamp,
Yeah, something reflective, bare bones. Something soft, something.
Do what you can right now. That's my advice. Get reference that you have in your house. Don't do anything special. You'll figure out lighting by studying lighting. It's really boring advice, but it's the advice that actually works.
I know that it's been 10 years of us dating, being together. And I still get impressed with myself when I know what your answer is going to be. Surf ninjas. I bet that one is still kind of dope, though, maybe.
Yeah, that was a good one. What?
Jeff Brown says, get good. That's your advice.
I mean, kind of, but not really. It's just, it's really just like when you find yourself feeling inadequate, do the work to get out. Like, do the work to remedy that. It's like if you identify weaknesses, then it's about working on those weaknesses.
Alex says, would you ever consider doing an art course, which you kind of have available right now on Patreon, which is tons of content.
Yeah, I mean, if you want any sort of in-depth tutorials, at least stuff I've done in the past, I'm working on another one that's more in-depth from the Ginyu Force image, but you can just go to the Patreon, which is the link in the description below this video.
Riley says, I can still listen to the first Linkin Park album on loop. It was the first album I ever wanted. Got it for my 10th birthday. Always gets me hyped to tell my dad who the loser really is.
Yeah, absolutely.
Aww.
Yeah, I remember my brother got me that Linkin Park album when I was like in sixth grade or something. Mm-hmm. Whenever it came out, I can't really remember. But yeah, I was hyped on it. I have a very vivid memory of playing.
You would have been much older because
eighth grade. I don't know when it. When did it come out?
Well, because Riley, I think, is 30 now, so I think you guys are 6 years apart. So you would have been 16 if you got it when it came out.
So my brother got it for me, and I specifically remember playing an emulator on my computer, Shining Force 2, while listening to Linkin Park. So I was playing that game, listening to Mr. Han or whatever that DJ was.
That's funny. I was in middle school when Linkin Park was like coming out and popular and all that. And all I think about when I hear Linkin Park is the anti-suicide videos that they show, because that's always what they put it over. That's literally all I think about. And then my brother listened to it, so I didn't like it because I inherently didn't like my brother.
Yeah. Okay, well, we're going to hop off of here. I spent that hour and a half just drawing this. Just drawing all those plants.
I like it. It's very pretty.
Thanks. Yeah, we can zoom in on it. Let's get some plants. Yeah, you see I did a bird, and I got chimpanzee guy over here, which I did a kind of drawing on, and then I got my little pedestal here, which is incredibly detailed and crazy looking, which spent actually didn't take me that long. When I don't adhere to any reference, I can just kind of wing it and do shapes and designs. So that's all that is. It's just a giant base for this dude to stand on. It's super detailed. With some leaves on it, I guess. Mercy is for the weak. But yeah, if you want to help support, you can go to the Patreon below and join up. I'll be posting this up with some more detail as far as how I did it. And then I'm going to paint this one up, actually. I'll show you how that looks. Let me actually shut my screen off for a second so that I don't pull up NDA work by accident. And I'll show you what it looks like when you paint this style, or at least when I paint this style. So this is what I did. So basically I just drop some colors beneath it and then go over it and start painting. So it's going to be something like this, like when I'm done, but I'm going to keep two versions of it. Like I'm going to keep a pen and ink version and I'm going to keep a painted version. But the nice thing about this style is that I have like a pretty easy time melding this quasi inking look with a painterly look. So that jump into painting, it doesn't feel like I'm painting over an inked piece. It feels more like I'm just continuing the render. So yeah, feels good, and I'm pretty excited to paint the whole thing up. And you know, I'm doing all the busy work right now. You just want to get a very strong structure down. So that's basically what it is just drawing it all out. But yeah. Couple last questions. Mancer asks, Dave, do you ever attend colleges as a guest speaker? No, not really. I'm not really asked that often. But yeah. This isn't super important question, but what's your opinion on frogs? Love frogs. I caught 150 of them or so in a summer when I was a child, and then I put them all into an above ground pool where by the end of the summer they all died and my backyard smelled like rotten frog piss and swamp water. And then my dad used a axe to chop off the wall of the pool, and the whole pool went down the hill in my yard, and there was just about a million, well, I mean, I guess literally there was like 150 dead frogs rolling down a hill into the forest. It smelled for a while. So that's how much I like frogs. And thank you all for hanging out. And if you missed the stream, it'll be up. You'll be able to rewatch this. And yeah, that's the painter version. This is the ink version. And I'll be probably streaming more of this. This is just an original character.